sare ba
Ah.
सास ननद मोरी तोरानी, सास ननद मोरी दोरानी जेठनिया, सास ननद मोरी दोरानी जेठनी, मैं तो उन्हीं को लाज लगा From where I stand, it looks like a long, enjoyable road, and something that happens over time. And it is a fascinating process at that. Something that the more you delve into the subject, the more fascinating it gets, the more surprising it gets as to how much there is involved in this assimilation of gaikis and gharana gaikis and styles. As I get more and more wonderstruck, I also see around me a rather interesting phenomenon that's going on. On one hand, the number of listeners by and large has increased, which is a good thing. The number of musicians taking to the stage is also a good thing. But I do feel like, as Arun Kaka was mentioning today, that we are getting more and more content with a rather low baseline in terms of what we're presenting. A basic formula presentation, pehle thoda sa alap kiya, and then you have a vilambit and a little bit alap in that, and a taan, and we're content with that, and to call that classical music. And it is only when we delve a little deeper, have more conversations like we had this morning, that we realize that there is so much more involved. There is this deep parampara of musicians who have created and weaved and woven magic through their alaps, through their taan, through their behlavas. And every musician has given something very special and unique. When one gets drawn into that aspect, that nuanced form of listening, the level of enjoyment, the level of involvement tremendously increases. So from an audience point of view, I think that is something that is very critical, and I'm very glad that First Edition Arts is doing this, has taken this initiative of including lectures and lecture demonstrations by veteran musicians as a part of educating the listener into not just the basics, but also the more nuanced ideas. We heard such beautiful things that gana avrohi hota hai. What does that exactly mean? What does it mean to understand the aesthetic of a certain gharana gaiki, the emotional quality of it, the discipline that goes into it, the structure that goes into it, of every cycle that's passing by? And we were just talking earlier today, and I was just remembering how when you stand before a painting at an art gallery, you might go, there's this beautiful Van Gogh painting that you're looking at. And you look at it and say, that's nice, it's drawn some dead flowers. And then a slightly more keen observer and someone who wants to appreciate the art will go and say, oh, they look so lifelike. You know, so that's a certain deeper level of trying to appreciate it, the colors and the textures. And then when someone comes by and goes into what it took in the context of the time that he lived in, what were the paints that were available at the time, what did it take for him to create that technique and pioneer that work, your whole appreciation of that art goes so much higher. Likewise in music, if there was some insight that we as artists could give and the audience could take the effort to imbibe, I think the whole narrative of where our music is and where it should be going will drastically change. And it is, to a large extent, the musician's responsibility to cultivate that. And for a musician to get there to a place where he's able to understand and assimilate gharana gaikis and nuances of music, there are a few things that are required. First, I think extended amounts of time receiving guidance from able gurus, listening to great stalwarts from the past, a tremendous respect and awareness of the past, and seeking to understand each great musician of the gharana and what they did with it. You know, during our Talim, when I was a student learning from him, I still go to him and learn, but I'm saying when I was immersed in just Talim and not performing in any you know, on stage yet, there was a time when he was teaching us and he would sometimes teach us a particular Tan variety or some kind of an idea, and then he would throw out a name, Nivruti Bhasan Naik, or Kesar Bhai, or anybody, you know, Antubha, whatever. And then we would go back and source these tapes, cassettes, or, you know, some form of recordings of theirs, and listen. And then suddenly we would understand where that came from. So this, what we heard and what we understood and appreciated so much in one man singing comes from so many other sources behind him, before him. And you begin to understand that this process is not a matter of imitation, but it is to see, to understand, to assimilate each musician's interpretation of the basic principles of that gharana gayaki. It is how each of them has interpreted that gharana gayaki. And when you see that, you see what has gone behind their assimilation process. I think for us as a musician who's trying to find our path, that nazar, that drishti with which they sought to understand their gayaki is invaluable. The quest to do something new begins to appear futile when you look back and see it's all done. To paraphrase T.S. Eliot, I just very quickly quote from his essay, Tradition and Individual Talent. He says, no poet, and this applies to musicians as well, no poet or musician is relevant just by himself. No poet or musician can stand alone and claim any value or significance. Every poet or musician is a cumulative of all the poets and musicians that have existed before him or her. We are being influenced by every one of them, even those long dead and gone, even those we have never heard. They continue to live through our music, and that music is never of the past. Our music today is rather merely a present condition of the past. So when we were asked this question earlier about how do you merge these gharanas, I don't think we seek to merge anything. We just try to understand them. We try to observe them, explore them, understand them, and assimilate them with a sense of deep surrender. Until and unless we surrender to those gharanas, to those, you know, the tradition that has existed, with utmost humility, and to realize that we are a speck in that ever-flowing river, or rivers, as in this case, I think that's an idea that has helped me tremendously in my own growth. To try and seek out what is essential rather than what is new. So, to sum what I was trying to say up, I was just trying to say that this process is a very fulfilling process of understanding gayakis, gharanas, as the musicians of our past understood them. Just trying to get a sense of what they did and understand that, I think, is the best that we can do. Before I begin my second piece, I would like to very quickly quote a small passage from one of the greatest jazz legends of all time, John Coltrane, about what we should focus on as the essentials of music. He says, we should pray for and seek knowledge which would enable us to portray and project the things we love in music. We should pray for and seek knowledge which would enable us to portray and project the things we love in music in a way that might be appreciated as having been conceived, composed, performed, or presented with dedication and in positive taste. With this mindset and with an acute sense of the appreciation of our tradition, as we do our sadhana, if something fresh, something new comes out of it, which it very likely will, so be it.